viewers, it is certain that wherever we go today, wherever we appear to be, we are surrounded by rights. We have talked earlier on about rights. What are the rights and how to categorize such rights? And we were in agreement that rights could be divided into three categories as follows: human rights, legal rights, and customary rights. However, still, we are living in the era of rights. Laws are enacted within domestic national jurisdictions as well as at international law jurisdiction, and every law that is out there is conferring rights and imposing obligations on individuals and on groups. Today, I would like to talk about the conflict of rights. And in this case, rights can converge and also can diverge. Rights can be in agreement and rights can be in disagreement. I would like to look at the case of Magaya versus Magaya. This is a case that in itself represents the conflict of rights as one may imagine today. We live in a changing dynamics of judicial systems. We live in a world in which people as individuals and as groups do claim their rights and entitlement to such rights. Magaya versus Magaya is presenting to us the following case in particular and making reference to the following facts in issue. A person known as Magaya, with African descent, a Zimbabwean from the Shona community and an adherent to the Shona customary law, passed away. He died without a will. That means he died intestate. Magaya died after his marriage under the Shona customary law to two wives. And in that case, he was rightfully polygamous. The first wife gave birth to a daughter, Venia Magaya, and the second wife gave birth to three sons, and the second called Nakai Magaya. According to the Shona customary law, when one dies intestate, under the customary law, his estate shall be administered and distributed in accordance with the customary law, and in this case, the Shona customary law. Nakai Magaya, one of the three sons, moved to the local community court under the Local Court Act, seeking to be given the rights in accordance with the Shona customary law to be the administrator of the estate of the deceased, which of course the community court ruled in his favor. Venia Magaya, the only daughter of Magaya, the late, moved to the Supreme Judicial Court seeking her rights as a woman and as a daughter of the deceased to be the heir of the estate of the deceased. The Supreme Court ruled upholding the decision made by the local community court that had upheld the customary law and ruled in favor of Nakai Magaya as the rightful hereditor and the rightful administrator of the estate of the deceased. The claims made by Venia Magaya are as follows. This ruling is the prima facie breach to the Zimbabwean constitution, and there's no doubt it is also the prima facie discrimination against the females. It is in this contention that we see the outrage raised by the human rights community in Zimbabwe and in Africa, as well as from other countries, that is from the international community, against the Supreme Judicial Court ruling in Harare that was seen as an affront to the women's rights, an affront to the human rights and the international law. In this case, in particular, however, this is still the lighter portion of the entire argument. The argument here before us is based and anchored on the hierarchy of rights, or the what we'd call the priority of rights and prevalence of rights. Is it proper to look at the rights in line of hierarchy according to their priorities and importance? This would be contradicting to the principle of equality of rights. All rights are considered equal. By all the standard and in accordance to this particular ruling before us, it is a question of whether the Supreme Judicial Court was subjected under obligation to rule referring itself to the priority or the hierarchy of rights, perhaps beginning with the international law rights, then going to the constitutional rights, then descending to the legislative rights, and lastly, the customary rights. This is the question that many jurists are seeking to address. Many law scholars are questioning, interrogating the question of dividing the rights or categorizing the rights, prioritizing the rights. Can we look at some rights as greater than others, some rights above other rights? Well, this is understood to be in violation of the rights of women, not only of Zimbabwe, but of the entire humanity. It is seen as a ruling that is against the justice meant for women, and in this case, the equality principle within the international law. The non-discrimination principle within the international law. But the other side of the argument, though, is the question of the indigenous self-determination principle, which is also within the international law, within the United Nations Charter, as well as the known 1966 two international covenants of human rights, one international covenant on civil and political rights, the other one, the international covenant on economic, social and cultural rights. About the indigenous rights and traditional rights of the people. These are the rights that have been also echoed in the UN Declaration on the Indigenous Populations' Rights, or in rights of the indigenous populations around the world. Of customary rights based on communities, and these rights that have been echoed also by the international community, is a question of elevating such indigenous rights to the level of equality of rights at international level. That is the jurisprudence of the human rights. It is painful to see Miss Magaya missing out in her hereditary rights because of being a female. It is painful to see Venia Magaya being houseless in a community where she is proud of being part and parcel of such cultures, of such laws, legal systems. And there is nothing against Miss Magaya accessing her rights under the Constitution of Zimbabwe and her rights under the international law. Nothing against Miss Magaya in person by the virtue of being female. There is nothing in favor of Nakai Magaya because he's a male, and that is a patriarchal society or gerontocratic society in which females are considered inferior to males when it comes to succession, when it comes to the justice system, that might see more meaning in the males versus the female. Magaya versus Magaya, indeed, the ruling is very controversial. It is debatable. It's a subject of the point of views by different people around the world. But indeed, the rights of Miss Magaya in this material case were breached by the judicial system. Another side of the story is to look at the leveraging of the rights. Is it possible to see certain rights generated by certain laws as superior and prevailing over other rights? Then, if we are on the affirmative, that means that rights are not equal. And when rights are not equal, it would also not make any meaning to talk about the equality principle, because obviously some rights will prevail over the others. And in the same hierarchy, it is a question of, if the court had ruled, within quote, in favor of Miss Magaya's claims, then Mr. Magaya would have lost the case on the condition that the customary law of the Shona people is considered inferior, or a subset of the hierarchy of laws and regimes and rights in Zimbabwe. Is it making sense to argue that the Constitution is inferior to the international human rights laws? Is it right to argue that the Constitution of Zimbabwe is superior to the legislation and as well as the customary jurisdiction? If we do this, then we are arguing as follows, that rights are not equal and in that subject of inequality of rights, we can address inequality of humans that are entitled to enjoyment of such rights. This is a question of reconsidering and rethinking the position of the customary rights and other rights if the customary rights are to be considered inferior or the substandard rights or there are no rights. Then at the same time we are denying the indigenous self-determination rights. We are denying that there are indigenous rights. We are denying the fact that the people's cultures may not count when it comes to the conflict of rights. My question and my predicament is about the lack of codification of the customary rights or the customary laws that would enable us to make such norms and rules predictable and the customary justice more acceptable, legitimate, and understandable by the legal community. It is a question of whether the Supreme Judicial Court, whether Justice Muchechetere would have ruled in favor of Mr. Magaya or in favor of Ms. Magaya, it would have still not settled the matter as we have it. The question is, however, that we need to engage our discussions with the issues such as how do we admit that rights are equal until they get into conflict, then we start asking ourselves, interrogating the question of prevalence and the hierarchy of such rights. I would like to get your position. Act on this matter on a serious note and give your view whether the ruling of the Supreme Judicial Court of Harare was justified in favoring the customary law jurisdiction against the Constitution and against the international human rights. The question is out there. It is you to give us your position. Then we start from there. Thank you for watching. Peter here, University of Nairobi, encouraging you to keep on following this video channel. Remember to subscribe and remember to give us the likes. And bye for now.